as the storm provides the perfect backdrop, I record this week's intro. Now, before I get to this week's guest, I've had a bit of an experience over the last week or so. Now, in my little town that I live in, about 5,000 people, we have had what is called RSV, which is a respiratory virus, go through the local primary school. And when I say go through the local primary school, I mean hundreds of kids wiped out because of this virus. And you may notice that my voice is a little huskier than usual. I'm recovering from my version of the lurgy that my beautiful daughters passed on to me. Now, RSV is known to be deadly to small children, babies, and smaller children who catch it badly. It's a respiratory virus. Now, if that is true, is that not more dangerous than the dreaded beer virus that we've been dealing with for the last 18 months that has a 99.94% survival rate and doesn't kill children? Isn't a virus that kills children probably more dangerous and more concerning than one that kills 90-year-olds? Remembering that the average age of death for the beer virus is past the average age of human life expectancy. I've just been observing this. Like, there would be hundreds of cases in the local area of this RSV and versions of it. And my poor little daughter got a secondary middle ear infection, and anyone's had one of those knows how much that sucks. However, something that can give you a chest infection and can at times be deadly to small children, and also provoke secondary infections in those that suffer it, surely is more of a concern than what we've been facing, yet it's not, along with all the other things that we've discussed in the last few episodes. Look, I don't want to go on too much about that. I just wanted to share that with you. I wanted to put that thought in your mind, into the ether, because it was almost a direct comparison to what is going on, and no one said anything, yet half a primary school was at home over the last week because of a virus. Anyway, this week's guest. This week, we welcome Duncan Burns to the podcast. To say I'm proud of what Duncan has achieved, mainly for himself, however, the ongoing work that he does for the community and to helping youths that are in jail get back on the straight and narrow as much as they can, and the plans that he has to provide them for a transition place, for want of a better term, is amazing. Duncan is an ex-student of mine, and we've been trying to sit down for a little while, and I had no idea the depth of Duncan's story. We all have our own story. However, sometimes someone's story is a little crazier than yours, or a little crazier than one you've heard, and that's Duncan's story. I don't want to share it here. I want you guys to listen to it and get into it. I've got to find some hilltop hoods for Duncan. He wanted some hilltop hoods for the music for this one. I'm not sure that I have the songs that Duncan wants, so I'll just be liberal with the ones that I choose. Have a look forward to a little bit of Aussie hip-hop. I haven't got too much more. This conversation was excellent, and the work that Duncan is doing is to be applauded. And as I said, I'm very proud of what he's achieved. And once you hear his story, I'm proud of what he's overcome, because it's a hell of a thing to do and to keep moving forward. Right, it's a good example of just to keep moving forward. Did a bit of a logo change today, bit of a refresh using some of the graffiti art that Chris Thompson, who's a loyal listener of the podcast, did for me a little while ago. That will evolve and change. I love the sacred geometry stuff, however, looking at a more succinct logo to catch people's attention. Let me know if you like it, let me know if you don't. It's all good either way. I'll be re-engaging with my discipline once I get over this little lurgy. Remember to stay disciplined, stay focused, be kind, be cool, and look after yourselves. We'll chat soon. Cheers.
needed a guide like a blind veteran's dog. Cause I was going nowhere like a child's letters to God. The knife's road was hard, I was never so lost that I looked for an answer and I met as a boss. I never did pop pills or cocktails, just rock tills. Kids with skills still got a rasp for cops still. They had me in the back of a paddy down the locker. Smack me, pat me down for a bag. Mom's a rocker. And bail me out, I fuck you out once again next weekend. Bail me out drunk again. And I never will forgive myself for putting you through all that hell. I went from high school dropout to factory laborer, slave to the clock until four. Went from sleeping on the floor to being out on tour. Now no stopping me, I'll finish with a bang like a Cobain's biography.
Going down a hard road.
Down the hard road.
Enough to buy a drink was on a path to nowhere. The heart of the road, the more broken baggage we carry, the larger the load. The school drop bag, I'm knocked out, chased by the cops out, got clout, dumped by my girlfriend and locked out. Been broken, being even choked to being a dope MC, but never lost hope and dreaming. We used to thrash, push the car, silver engine and fail. If I never had bail, maybe I'll be dead or in jail. Oh man, I got no one else to blame. I'll thank my family and music for keeping me sane. But that's the place where I started working late nights, never seeing daylight, getting paid like a slave might. And I've done too many years to miss this for my missus to have to tell my son he nearly never existed.
Going down a hard road.
Down the hard road.
Spirit of truth, cause all these kids that I meet, man, they mirror my youth. And I could have gone the wrong way,
the easy option,
but I chose to go the long way.
So
keep a lookout, look out, be ballers, keep your hook up, pull a page, rip my book out, and pull out your finger, put your foot out. And keep a lookout for what we put out, the brand new flavor for your cookout.
G'day everyone, welcome back. It's a great pleasure to introduce you guys to Duncan Burns. And it's his first experience in the refinery, mate. How are you going?
Yeah, good, thanks, mate. Good to have me.
Mate, it's this one's been a long time coming. Bit of history on me and Duncan. Duncan is an ex-student of mine. He's been a listener of the podcast from practically the beginning. But what's more important is the work that he's been doing. And me and Duncan have kept in contact for the last three or four. Are we trying to work it out? 3 or 4 years? Or how long is that?
Who knows? Man, it'd have to be
nearly 4 years. 3 years, 4 years?
Yeah, three, probably four.
Yeah. Crazy, isn't it?
Mm.
So, you know, me and Duncan have been chatting on and off for all those years, and he's been observing what I've been observing what he's doing, and the time has come that we sit down and have a discussion. He's been a guest on the Black Dog Brotherhood podcast, Mr. Geddes, and a couple of others as well. You're on Triple M last week. Was it last week, week before?
Last week. Yep.
Last week, and you did a bit on A Current Affair that hasn't been released yet, is that?
To be released, yeah, when the tennis finishes.
If it ever finishes.
Yeah.
But, mate, where did you want to start? What did you want to share with the listeners? I know we've got a few topics that we want to cover. However, I leave it to you, mate. It's your first experience in the refinery. I want you to try and steer the conversation. What do you want to do, mate? Where do you want to start?
Oh, there's so many places I can start, mate.
Well, the problem is we've been in here for an hour already chatting. So you, what about, you share your story excellently on Neil's podcast in great detail. So we don't have to go into that amount of detail here. But why don't you give a pre-seed version of your personal journey as a young fella? Like, you know, for example, I only learned a few minutes ago when I tagged you in an Instagram post that brothers keep a 45 and 45 is the caliber bullet that you were shot with. So, I mean, that's obviously the seminal story. And it's interesting too, man, and I said this to you before, it's like of all the conversations we had all those years ago before we sort of went on the journey, you never told me that. You never told me any of that stuff and you weren't ready to tell anyone. But now you tell it in a public space, which is to be applauded. So what happened, mate? Well, you were rolling with the bikies, weren't you, back then? Is that?
I grew up in a good household. I had some early childhood trauma. My younger sister died a cot death. I don't know whether I found her and alerted my mum, or you know, I was close to my mum when that happened, but that created the situation where I blacked out the first 7 years of my life. Went through, you know, primary school and all that, just feeling like I didn't fit in. High school was the same. Got to 15, had my first girlfriend, first sexual experience with her, hadn't, you know, it was, you know, love, you know,
love, yeah,
at
yeah.
15, yep. you know what I mean? She cheated on me, so I went into a real deep dive. Like,
dark spring.
Really dark, man. Really, really dark for about 6 months.
Yeah.
And I got introduced to pot then by one of the guys I was going to high school with, obviously. Yeah, back then got to the point of smoking cones before, as soon as I got up in the morning, smoking in the afternoon when I got home. Even though I was playing sport, like highly involved in sports in high school, was just really tapping out, really, like just trying to escape the depression. Like,
did weed eventually win over sport?
I guess, yeah, I'd have to say it did, man. Yeah. I have to say it did.
Because that's, honestly, if I look back, if I look back in my heavier smoking days, in my about the same age, 16, 17, I was playing senior football, and if I look back, I gave it away to smoke billies, it won eventually. The weed won out.
Well, I reckon I burnt myself out because I was doing that much, like, on the sport side of things. Like, yeah, I was playing, you know, second 15 football in high school, training 3 mornings a week, training 3 afternoons a week, plus Saturdays. In the summer, I was rowing 3 mornings a week, 3 afternoons a week, plus rowing on the Saturday competition. School holidays, I was doing 70 Ks a day. Every day of the school holidays, that was like peak fitness. I cut everything out when I was that age. I think it was about 16.
So there's some obsessive behavior there. Do you think that was, you were just trying to deal with the trauma of
it? Was what I know now.
Yeah.
After all the work I've done in the last two and a half years of sitting in circles and doing men's work, it was my shadow. It was part of my shadow of not feeling good enough. You know what I mean? Not doing well in school, so I'd excel it. And my competitiveness was just off the charts.
Yeah.
Like, if I wasn't winning, man, I was beating myself up.
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean? It's like,
second place is the first loser kind of thing.
Yeah, yeah. I was just, you know, that old story, I'm not good enough from, you know.
Self-worth.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I ended up, you know, finishing up in high school, still playing rugby union after high school. But not really 100% into it like I was at school. As I said, I reckon I burnt myself out from like that amount of training.
It's too much. It's too much for it. Like, I know some of the, one of the other boys, his son does soccer and he's only 11 or something like that. And the amount of training they've got to go through, it's like, it doesn't make any sense to me that you've got to have room to be a child, to be a teenager, to experience life.
Totally. And for me, and I can only speak for me, the joy of it was gone.
Yeah,
there was no joy in it anymore.
Yeah.
Like every you say, you know, I'll go out there and have fun. Fun went out of it years before that with the amount of training. Just push, yeah, you know, to the point of break. And so, you know, played football, dislocated my shoulder, and then that was it. I said, that's it, I'm done. I don't want a reconstruction. I don't want nothing like that.
Mm.
So then I was already finished up in school and was working in a pub. Mm-hmm. So I was smoking pot, drinking already at that stage. Started working with a woman there who was the wife of a member.
Mm-hmm.
Met him, was drinking with him when he used to come down after the meetings or, you know, whatever nights to pick her up from work.
Yep.
Get on the drink with him. Then they invited me out to a bike show. Mm-hmm. Went out there, got introduced to speed for the first time. Went to an after party after a bike show.
They're good fun, aren't they? Aren't they good fun? I've seen some shit at those after
parties. At 19, man. Yeah. At 19.
Yeah, me. That's when I was doing all that stuff as well. Yeah.
It's just like, man, it's like I finally worked out where I fitted in.
Right.
It
gave you a sense of belonging.
That was what dropped for me. But even saying that, and this comes up for me every now and then too. When I was about 12, we used to travel up the coast from Sydney up to Ballina, where my grandparents were living and still live, or my grandmother does. We were heading up the coast back then, and I think I was about 12, you know, the old Pacific Highway.
Yep.
And we were driving, I can't even remember where we were. We were halfway up there or whatever, and all we could hear was this noise, this hectic noise. It was like thunder.
Yeah.
It was calming. And we got to an overtaking lane, and the old man's bailed into the left lane, and then whoom, whoom,
whoom, whoom, whoom. Yeah.
About 40 Comancheros went past.
Yep.
And it was just the loudest fucking
noise.
Yeah. At 12, and as I said, I forgot about this for years, and I think I only remembered it after I left the club.
Mm.
At 12, I went, that's what I want.
Yeah, right.
So at that early already,
age. Already pre-programmed in your mind.
In subconscious, man.
Isn't that interesting?
So whether, you know, they talk about manifestation, whether in some level I manifested into my life later on.
Yeah.
And that was the eyes. And I mean, we actually used to live just down the road from the Comancheros clubhouse in Sydney at Pennant Hills there. And my grandmother actually lived not far from where the Milperra Massacre was.
Yeah, right.
So it was... Once again, looking back at
echoes,
it.
Echoes, there's echoes, there's... It was in your periphery for a long time.
Yeah, man. I went out to that and that was it. It was like, fuck, I finally worked out where I fitted in, you know. And I hung around for a few years. Wanted to do it right. I wanted to suss it all out, and that's just who I am, you know. I'll walk into a room or a pub or a nightclub, and I'll stand with my back to the wall, and I'll just observe.
Yep, I agree,
That's just who I am. Yep. It's been embedded in me for as long as I know.
Yep.
I watched, you know, other guys go through and get their patch, and it's like, okay, well, the time came, and I managed to be able to build a bike, put a bike together and nom up, you know. And I saw a little bit of hectic stuff like going into it, and you know, the story was, well, that's what happens when you're a dog and this, that and the other. It's like, well, obviously that dude fucked up, so you know, you fuck up, there's consequences. So anyway,
I've been of that opinion since then, since I did my business. If you choose to take money from those gentlemen and you don't pay, or you don't come through with what you said you were going to do, then what did you think was going to happen?
Well, the bit I'm sort of referring to was a guy who was actually in there.
Right.
And it got found out that he'd apparently made statements in a situation.
Oh, that's even worse.
Yeah, well, you can imagine the repercussions from that.
Yes.
And I was the witness to it.
Yeah.
And the thing was, well, that's what happens.
Yeah.
And it's just like, oh, guess he fucked up.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big thing for me, not to fuck up.
Not to fuck up. There's a good example of not to do that.
Yeah. You know, and it's always, you know, tell the truth.
Mm.
You know, no matter how bad it is, just tell the truth. Mm-hmm. If, you know, if you cop it, you cop it. But anyway... Yeah, nommed up and was just getting looser and looser while I was nomming. You know, drugs became even, you know, obviously more prevalent in my life.
Yep.
Went through, saw a whole heap of stuff. as I said again, met the mother of my daughters back then. We hooked up, and that, you know, we were in a relationship for the majority of, or for more than my time in the club.
Mm-hmm.
She had a really bad car accident. We lost our first child in that. She had a head on doing 100 k's an hour.
Out the
back of Windsor, just buckled, fully buckled a VN Commodore.
Yep.
Just almost like in a bit of a V shape.
Yeah, right.
Smashed the engine back through the engine wall into the front seats, just smashed the legs. Funnily enough, I beat the helicopter to the Westmead Hospital from out the back of the Windsor on the bike.
Yeah, right.
One of those off-tap units. Little snippets. And then just kept going and just became more treacherous.
Yeah.
Just as time went on, it just got more and more treacherous until the point where I got shot.
And what led up to that? Why?
Gang war.
Yeah.
Over drugs and shit.
And what's this? That's the early 2000s. So that was sort of the height of it.
Nah, 2000, believe it or not, it was 27th of March, which was Good Friday in 2005.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, that's, if you, you know, understanding, and look, there's a lot of younger people that listen to this podcast, so they wouldn't know that back then there was a lot of, what are we going to say, Middle Eastern people coming into certain clubs, and the brotherhood that it once was basically didn't fail, but it became very unstable because these guys are loose units.
And it wasn't just them either. It was my generation that was coming through that was corrupting the older fellas.
Yep.
Like they were bringing in the massive amounts of...
whatever it is.
Yeah.
Yep.
To you know, pseudo to turn into speed.
Yep.
And I mean massive amounts, man. Massive amounts. So the old guys that were supposedly old school that wasn't soon before they all started seeing dollar signs, man.
Yeah, okay.
And then on top of that, you had, you know, the influence of the Middle Eastern way of doing things.
Yep.
And, it's a pretty slippery slope, as you know, when that sort of shit starts to take a hold.
Absolutely. And look, a lot of people wouldn't, as I say, the guys of our generation could remember what happened during those days with the bikie wars up and down the East Coast into the Northern Territory. Like, it was all happening.
Yeah, yeah.
All over the show.
Mm.
And... yeah, it was not uncommon for gun battles to take place back then. That wasn't an irregular thing. Whereas years before that, it was not a very common thing. Things were taken care of behind closed doors, and all of a sudden it spilled out onto the streets. And I think you're right, you know, the quantity of product that was being moved through that, along with, you know, people consuming vast quantities of that product as well.
And egos. Massive egos. Yeah.
And speed always helps your ego.
Yeah. Yeah, it has that effect.
Yeah, that's right. The money and the cash that was flowing through that. Yeah, right. So you got shot in the back. Was that?
We're on our way to a memorial run. Basically it was right in the middle of a war, but we're not going to change our day for them.
Yep.
You know, basically fuck them.
Yeah.
We're going to do it.
Uh-huh.
My sergeant come down, picked me up, me and a life member that lived down the road came over, but I knew something was wrong. I woke up that morning and I was sick in the guts. I mean, like to the point of wanting to vomit.
The instincts had kicked in.
Yeah. Something was already telling me. And I even had the voice. Don't get on the bike. Tell him you're sick. Tell him you're sick. Yeah. Tell him you're sick. Yeah. Tell him you're sick. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't. And it's just like, just shut the fuck up. Get on the bike. Harden the fuck up. Just,
yeah. Well, that's the mentality too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Get on the bike. Do it. So anyway, we took off 45 minutes later, turned down a few streets away from my VP's house. Drove past a couple of cars, and just by chance, we switched formation, and I come out behind him going through a roundabout, and he had the life member on the back. Went past a parked car, and just as we went past a parked car, something caught my eye, and I looked in my side view mirror, and I could see someone peeling out of the car, and then the next thing, crack, and then, blacked out, obviously. Come to across the other side of the road, you know, lucky nothing was coming the other way. Otherwise, it would have been going through the windscreen or under it. Yeah, realised what had happened. My sergeant had pulled in behind me. We went through the next roundabout on the wrong side. I dropped down a gear and then just knew that the only way I was going to live was to get to that house. And it was about a K away. I worked it out later on. So just as we did that, I looked in my mirrors and I saw the car do a U-turn and someone get out of the car waiting for me to drop to finish the job. Bullet went in my back. It came out my chest. It should have blown my heart out of my chest from the trajectory.
Yeah.
But when it hit my back, it straightened up, went straight through.
So it bounced off a rib and went straight through sort of thing.
Didn't even bounce off a rib, man. Hit my jacket, straightened up, went in between ribs in the front and the back. All it got was a punctured lung.
Really?
Yeah.
Fuck, man.
Yeah. And then so I put my hand on my chest and, you know, wound it out, got to the up the hill. To the end of the street, had to change down gears, and by that stage I could see like hundreds of individual rays of sunlight. That whole riding up the hill, riding up that part of the road, I could feel the blood pumping out down my back, every heartbeat, and just saw those individual rays of sunlight, and I went, this is it. Turned in the street, pulled up out front of the house, basically fell over with a bike on top of my legs. That was it. They dragged me out, and I just remember being slapped in the face, you know, them screaming at me. And I just actually looked up to whoever it was, my VP at the time, and just said, you know, just tell my missus and kid I love them. I'm gone.
So checking out. Yeah.
I'm out. The next thing, what I worked out later on was I was still out. I mean, you know, I don't even know how long it took the ambos to get there, but obviously they brought me back.
Yeah.
And the next pain was them jamming hoses through my rib cartilage to keep the blood draining out
to free up whatever they needed to do.
Try and do whatever it was to keep me alive.
Wow.
Yeah, and then checked myself out after 3 days.
Of course you did.
Yeah.
Straight back to the clubhouse?
No, just out running around like a dickhead. Like...
Oh, looking for...
Yeah. I actually made the nurses pull the hoses out. I made them pull them out, and as soon as they pulled them out, I didn't even let them stitch me up.
Really?
Yeah. I was that off my head on, like, still in shock, and off my head and just what everything and the... whatever it was they were giving me. I was allergic to morphine. I can't remember the other thing they give you.
Pethidine?
Nah. No. Anyway. Yeah, I was out there. It was just like, get me out of here. I can't stay here. I just made the nurses pull the hose out. And he said, "Me, you can't go. I said, fucking just pull the hoses out. I'm out. Went and signed the papers, walked out, got to the big glass doors at the front door of Westmead Hospital. And by that stage, I was just swaying, you know. And my missus at the time, who was, you know, the mother of my girls, she just said, "You can't go. You've got to stay. I just said, "Get the fucking car. We're going." And then over the next 4 weeks, in and out of hospital, blood transfusion, still internally bleeding. In the end, couldn't lay down to sleep. I was getting the sweats, and I knew when I was getting the sweats, I said, "Yeah, right, son, this isn't good." Mm. Drove myself back up to the hospital and checked myself in again. And then I don't know what happened. I must have blacked out. I come to in a dark room, looking around, and there was a security guard in there. And they had all these young doctors coming in, checking me out, checking my charts, and I was like, "What's going on?" You know, I said to the security guard, I said, "Hey, man, what do all these doctors keep coming in for?" And he actually turned around and said, "Man, nobody can work out how you're still alive."
Yeah, right.
Yeah, they told me later, they ended up pumping 3.5 liters of blood and fluid out of my lung cavity, and what the pain was that filling up was coming across and crushing my other lung. Jesus. So starting to collapse my other lung. So internal infection, internal bleeding, all that sort of stuff, because I just wouldn't rest.
Did you find him?
No, luckily.
Yeah,
I was gonna say. Luckily. Yeah. I know I mean that from the bottom of, you know, my soul.
Because what would happen after that's a different story.
And yeah.
It's a different ending.
Stupidly back then, I would have been spending a fair bit of time in jail.
Yeah.
So, yeah, can't even explain how glad I am now as to...
That didn't follow through with that.
Yeah, how that didn't happen, yeah.
So did you exit after that or did you hang around?
A couple of months later I got out, yep. Watching my partner bring my eldest daughter at the time, who was 4 months old, into that hospital that last week that I was in there every day. It's just like, rightio, what do you want to do?
Yeah, what are you doing with your life?
Do I want to see my daughter grow up and be a big part of her life and be there as a father should be? Or do I want to keep being a dickhead and going down the road that I've had sign after sign after sign to get out?
Yeah.
And I've been too stubborn and too headstrong to go, no, I'm going to take it back to the way it was.
Yeah.
This isn't going to beat me and die or end up in jail. Like, really, what's fucking worth it?
Yeah. What's worth what at the end of the day?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't have a kid to not be in their life.
Yeah.
So, well, yeah.
Wow. Man, that's, you know, you talk about perspective, like, you know, and it's interesting. Is, you know, sitting in this room and obviously being a teacher for so long, everybody has their story, but that's definitely a story, man.
Oh, that's not even the end of it.
Yeah, right.
That's not even the end of it. So I got out, drove trucks just to try and get back ahead, because I'd been out of work for like 7 months by that stage. 4 months after I got shot, 3 months before, because my daughter had been born, and my missus at the time had real bad postnatal. So I quit my job, stayed home and looked after her. So I ended up with like $18,000 or 15 grand's worth of debt. Sold the bike to square up the debt. Drove trucks like a lunatic, doing, you know, 100 hours a week just to try and get back in front. Wasn't going anywhere with that. Did that for about 12 months, I think it was. And I've been chatting to other guys. Like, I still was... had mates in other clubs, and everybody knew what had happened.
Yeah.
So I had like a fair bit of respect from other crews, you know, other clubs.
Yeah.
And it was still that knowing what I know now from sitting in circle, it was that validation.
Yes. Well, there is, and look, it needs to be said as well. I mean, there was 2 or 3 years there from sort of 18 through to 22, where I was associated as well, and I used to do a few bits and pieces here and there. And look, sitting in circle, you could probably, and again looking back now, there's a certain brotherhood that is attached to that, and it almost, you know, the respect and the understanding and all those things. There's a lot of positives from a male perspective that come from that sort of association. It's only it's the darker aspects that catch up with you eventually, obviously. However, you know, bikie clubs were started by returned servicemen after World War II to help each other basically deal with what they saw. That's the reality of a lot of these clubs, and that's where they started. And, you know, brotherhood, you know, as you know, we've spoken about on the podcast a number of times, and we've spoken in the past about, is something that we're missing, you know, and that brotherly love and all those things. And that comes there. That is part of that. I mean, obviously there's ego and drugs and all that other stuff, but at a core understanding, there is brotherhood there. There is validation. There is respect and honor and all these things that, you know.
Well, that's why I joined. I saw that family aspect, and it was preached to me that it was that.
Yeah.
You know, and then, and I saw a couple of things, you know, like, members take on other guys' kids that had died, and their partner had died as well, so they took on their kids. But that's what I saw. I knew later on, and found out later on, there was hidden agendas behind that.
Yeah, that's there's leverage. Yeah.
No, or that plus
money.
Yeah. There was money, and what was hidden away, they knew what was hidden and where it was hidden and all that sort of stuff.
Right.
So there was coin involved, but what was presented was, this is what it's about.
Yeah, this is the family. This is what we do for each other.
Yeah. And then when you get in, you start actually learning what the story is, or the story comes out in the wash further down the track, which has happened, you know, with the treacherous shit that went on, you know, in there. And that was, the catalyst for me joining. But after I got shot, I had massive depression, like severe. I was diagnosed with severe PTSD, and knowing what I know now, I had PTSD before I left, or before I got shot.
Yes.
Then I got shot, then just massive dive, and just
I can only imagine the procedures, the pain, the blood, the hospital, the infection.
It was that part to it, but the worst part was knowing that what I was loyal to wasn't loyal to me.
Right.
And that everything I thought that it was fucking was and what it was supposed to be, it wasn't.
Yeah, okay.
And just that, having my heart ripped out of my chest.
So how, in what way, I don't follow. So like they didn't stick up for you in the end or they didn't look after you or anything else like that?
No, I mean, no.
So you took a bullet for them and they didn't basically.
I died and lucky I came back to see my daughter grow up and obviously have more kids now.
Mm.
But I put my life on the line.
Willingly too, I suppose. You would have, yeah.
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 That's just the type of person I was and I still am.
Still am, yeah. That's not a negative trait, however.
No, but it can be.
Absolutely.
It can be.
There's positives and negatives.
Yeah, if you don't, it's like anything, you don't see the red flags and you ignore them, it's going to bite you in the ass.
That's right, yeah. Right. Yeah, you only get so many of your fucking ups until it fucks up and you've got to pay attention.
Yeah, there's a tap on the shoulder, then there's a punch in the face. If that doesn't sink in, then there's a proverbial baseball bat to the back of the head.
That's right. It's a good analogy.
Yeah, though.
So you said that wasn't the end of the story, mate. So you're driving trucks for 100 hours. How does it culminate?
Yeah, well, I took off. That wasn't working, so I packed my family up, you know, went up to Central Queensland, moved up to Central Queensland, got a job in the mines, got the dream life, started all that, got into that. We didn't stay up there too long because my partner wasn't coping with it.
Yeah.
Wasn't coping with country town living.
Yeah, she's away from her support network and all those sorts of things.
Yeah, and I'm away for 5 days at a time.
Yep.
So that took a toll. Just by chance, we were on holiday back down the Gold Coast and I bumped into one of my old life members who was out by that stage as well. And my partner got on with his partner. So she went, we're moving back to the Gold Coast. I went, okay, Norwich, whatever needs to happen, if I need to fly in, fly out, travel, whatever, as long as you're okay and you've got some sort of support dealing with, you know, my daughter. Shortly after that, had another daughter. And then things just started to unravel.
Yeah.
Was going back on the weekends, getting on the drink and, you know, dabbling in this and dabbling in on that.
Yeah.
Making sure I was all right, but then it just crept in more and more and more. Things got worse. My partner wasn't coping. Like, she went back into her depression and wasn't coping, dealing on week off. We weren't connecting. We weren't having any quality time for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
I failed a drug test out at work and just blamed it on the relationship issues. Basically denial.
Mm-hmm.
It was denial.
It was denial, yeah.
I mean, that was having an effect, but I was blaming that.
Yeah.
Anyway, things just got worse. I've got to look at trying to create a business from home. I need to still pay the mortgages on the brand new house, pay the cars, pay this, you know, keep food on the table.
If you think no one cares, stop paying your bills. Yeah.
Yeah. And, but just providing a lifestyle for my kids, my two girls now, which were only young, you know, and my partner. One of the guys I was looking to go into business was not long out of jail.
Mm-hmm.
From doing what he used to do, same, you know, circle.
Same circles, yep.
Back into it, man. It's like, rightio, it's like, you know, what do I know best?
Yep. Like riding a bike.
Live that life for 10 years, man. And I see it with the guys I work with now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They come out of jail, or they come out of that life, they think they're burying their head in work is gonna make it all go away. But when they're coming out, you know, relationships on, you know, looking at falling apart, they've got kids, they've got, you know, bills, putting food on the table, all that sort of stuff. You know, they're on Centrelink payments, they're this, they're that, they're struggling, whatever, even though I wasn't in that space. And what's the easiest thing, you know, to get by?
Yeah, what's the easiest way to make a buck?
Yeah, go back to what you knew you were good at.
Yep.
You know, you might not have been, you know, the Scarfaces or whatever, but you got by.
Yeah.
You know, so
it was enough to make ends meet and can't pay the bills. Yeah.
But anyway, that started to play out, and in the end, that played out full on, like really, really full on. End up having to trigger a dead man switch to get out of that. she went down and put a dead man switches, go and see a solicitor, tell them the story, so you're not telling the cops a story. Tell the solicitor a story, and basically if I disappear or I suicide, this is the reason why.
Right. Got to that level.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Oh, the first solicitor I went to actually was he represented one of the main guys in that syndicate, and I didn't even know it.
Oh.
Which, like.
Oh.
Yeah.
Fuck.
Yeah. But what I worked out later was that's what saved my life. Inadvertently.
But he had all the dirt from.
Well, he had it, but one of the main dudes was in jail waiting to go to court. I guarantee he would have walked into that jail and said, listen, this dude has just shown me this, and basically saying that if he disappears or whatever, this is going to come out, and it's massive. So the word would have gone out, just let him go.
It's not worth it.
Let him walk, yeah.
It's not worth it.
So anyway, I went and saw another barrister to do the same thing, and the barrister had been working there he said to me, man, I've been doing this work for 20 years. He said, I can safely say that I've never seen anything like that in my life. And I went, yeah, I know. I'm paranoid. I'm this, I'm that. It's a Hollywood movie. Fucking rah, rah, rah. He goes, no, man, that's like a Tarantino movie.
Yeah, right.
He said, that's like next level shit.
Mm.
You know, and admittedly, yeah, I was on ice, and anybody can say, oh, this, that, and the other. But when somebody said to me back then, and it's still relevant now, when there's too many coincidences, they're not coincidences.
That's right, yeah.
You know? So there, they got to that stage, and there was once again, I either go to jail, end up dead in there from the amount of people that I've pissed off, or I end up dead. What do I do? I've got two young daughters, a partner. Things are fucked up, but I just walk away. Walk away from everything. But that relationship fell apart, obviously.
I
lost my job. I got made redundant at the same time and lost my license as well for 6 months or whatever it was due to points. So you had to walk away from everything. Lost the house, lost a lot.
Bottom.
Yeah, rock bottom. Shortly after, I was living in my car so I could let my partner and kids stay in the house. So they had a roof over the house till we figured out what we were going to do, how it was going to turn out. I was living in my car, lived in my car for nearly 4 months. At the end of that, just before I went back to the house to help her pack the house up, and we sold the house, which basically got square with the bank, I stood on a chair, started drinking one weekend, and yeah, stood on a chair with a rope around my neck. Couldn't do it, couldn't step off the chair. Had a couple of more drinks, got back up on the chair, wrapped the rope around my neck again, couldn't do it. And all right, guess I'm here for something. And I mean, you know, even in saying that, you know, looking back now, that, you know, however many year period of being in, you know, in the club, that was just like a suicide mission every day.
Yeah. You were redlining it to see what happened.
Pushing the envelope as hard as I could.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, that played out. And then I saw a TV, it was Today Tonight, actually. Yeah. They were reporting about the issues with youth around the Logan Woodridge area and how there was young girls of age of 13 prostituting themselves. And they had video footage of them.
Yeah.
Like the Salvation Army went through the streets, like showing Today Tonight, this is what it's like. And this was back in 2014. I saw that and just went, wow, my daughter is 10 years old.
She's 3 years off.
I could not even imagine her being in that space, having some dirty old man paying her to do whatever he wanted so she could get her next hit because her dad wasn't around.
Yeah.
Or whatever the case.
Whatever the situation
Whatever the story is.
Yeah.
And it's like, rightio, this is what I'm here for.
Okay.
This is why I'm still alive.
Yeah.
I'm here to bring farm programs in to youth detention and get young people out of detention centers, out of jails, out onto farms, and get them healing that way.
So that, I'm just thinking, man, like it's 2021. So you're only a couple of years out of all this when we met. Because you'd just done your first stint in that, where you'd been doing the youth justice stuff, and then
Yeah. I'd been a youth, like an unqualified youth worker. I managed to land a job, you know, universe doing its thing. Mm-hmm. I started volunteering at a place that was at Substation 33 in at Kingston.
Yeah.
Which is a place for, you know, disengaged youth and other programs they run out of there. Like, it's a social enterprise of youth and family services.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy that was a supervisor for the part of the, you know, programs that they ran, got done DUI. And I'd only been there like 2 weeks. And the boss goes, "You want a job?" I said, "Yeah." He goes, "No worries, sweet. Jump in here, go around doing lawns and maintenance and all that for emergency housing and all that with these young fellas." So I became a mentor to, you know, two or three young fellas. Mentor, you know, keep putting them through the daily grind of showing up for work and all that sort of stuff.
And turning up and being accountable.
Just having conversations with them too, find out what's going on in their life. And, you know, basically telling my story. So this is where I've been, man. This is where I'm at.
Mm.
Where I've been. This is where I'm at now. You know, and now it created an instant connection with them.
Yeah.
And then I went on to work with Indigenous youth running conservation land management programs.
Yeah, I've seen some of that stuff.
Yeah, well, that's after the third program, I had a falling out with the boss there, and he just said, "Man, it's you're not growing here. It's time for you to move on."
Mm.
And I was dirty at the time, but afterwards I just went, he was so right.
Mm.
He needed me. I needed that push.
You need to move on, yeah.
I needed that push to move on to the next step. And went on and did some more programs there with Indigenous out at Bowie, out of Bow Desert, on sacred land out there with Mananjali mob and that sort of stuff, running conservation land management programs there for the next company I work for, Access. And was it, just after that, one of the programs, the funding ran out or whatever, and then so I just had to get the next thing and just managed to get my forklift license again, and that's when I met up with you.
Yeah, right. Wow. That's a hell of a story, man. I think, you know, I understand, you know, the next major step of your journey was self-reflection. You know, you've got some really excellent ideas, and we've discussed these ideas a lot over the years. However, I think the key, you know, hearing that here in the refinery and being able to grasp it is a totally different thing to listening to it. And the next step was really self-reflection and self-assessment, would you say? Like, is that you had to try and actually excise some of these demons and bits and pieces that you had picked up, or what, you know?
Yeah. Well, I met up with my son's mum in that period.
Mm.
Or actually just as I was starting off as a youth worker, I met up with her and moved in with her. And she fell pregnant pretty quick and just went, right, I knew I was going to have another child. Like, I just had that deep knowing I was having another child even before I met her.
Yeah, right.
And I didn't know obviously who it was going to be with. It's just the way it played out. And things started to come up in that relationship.
Yeah.
I went, right, okay. So I booked myself in for psych sessions.
Mm-hmm. When trying to unpack some of this
stuff.
Yeah,
started doing CBT sessions.
Yeah.
Worked through the first, you know, 10 that you get on your mental health plan there.
Mm-hmm.
Got to the end of that and was, you know, doing all right. I thought, okay. Jumped on another 10, you know, and I think it was, third or fourth session through that, was I really came to peace with the relationship with my father and my parents.
Mm-hmm.
You know, going through that whole thing of blaming them for whatever it was, but in the end, they were only dealing with their shit. They were doing the best they could with what they had. With their conditioning and what their trauma they'd been through, losing kids. Like, my sister wasn't the only one they lost.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, my mum, I had another sister who was older than me that was stillborn, and mum had a heap of miscarriages.
Yeah, right.
So, you know, I really started to grasp it when I had my child as well.
Yeah.
Like, the penny dropped then. It's like, okay, fuck, they went through some stuff.
Yeah.
You know, and then it was only when I started doing the CBT that it really dropped.
Kicked in.
Fuck, they're just doing the best they could. They didn't know how to deal with me in depression and everything that I was going through.
Well, if they'd experienced that level of trauma, I mean, as you say, as a father now, you have a different lens of it to look through.
Mm.
they had their own depression, they had their own trauma, they had their own, and they're of that age group where there's a whole different set of issues with that age group.
Just bury it and keep going.
Yeah, exactly.
Just bury it and keep going.
Yeah.
Don't talk about it, just bury it and keep going.
Don't do anything.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, right.
So, yeah, I went through that, and then was it, I think it was when my son was about two, things started to, you know, the relationship, you know, with my son's mum started to unravel a bit.
Mm-hmm.
You know, believe it or not, once again, the universe, there was a guy two doors up that was running men's group.
Yep.
He was part of Man Up, which is a Kiwi sort of based.
I think if I remember correctly, we had an extensive discussion about whether or not you should go to that, and I remember encouraging you to go and check it out.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and I obviously took that advice.
Yeah,
it's like, what can I lose?
Yeah,
you know? And it served its purpose. Yeah. You know, I mean, I'm not religious. I have my own opinions on that.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, once again, each their own.
Yeah.
You know, if that's what...
If having faith gives you strength, then fine.
If that's what works for you, man, go for it.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yeah.
And it did work for me to a point.
Mm-hmm.
It got me into that mindset of, you know, showing up and sitting down with guys and once again, knowing what I know now from the work that I've done through Mankind Project, feeling safe and knowing that I can trust men again.
And express yourself without recrimination, I suppose.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Or judgment or victimization or and all of those, all of the above.
Yeah. And look, let's pause there and actually dig into that for a second because that's very important.
Mm.
I had an epiphany, it was during COVID times because obviously we couldn't do proper podcasting, so I was doing a lot of Zoom podcasts. And one of the boys, Woody, had he had a fluoro pink chair that he was sitting on for the Zoom session.
Yeah.
And no one said anything about it. And I'm like, I just want to give him the most amount of shit that I can think of for him having a fluoro pink fucking chair, right?
Mm.
And I'm like, what? But in saying that, I've got nothing but love for that man, right? Mm. I really, he's a brother from another mother.
Mm.
And it was, for whatever reason, that pink chair led me down a thought process of, I don't want to lose the joviality of Aussie men giving each other shit.
Mm.
Because it's beautiful. Like, it's fantastic.
Mm.
You know, some of the nights we've had, the poker nights out here,
yeah,
it is who can say the worst possible thing to each other, right?
Yeah.
But the difference is it comes from a place of love.
Mm.
Whereas I think in a lot of these instances where we have been teased or bullied or insulted or victimized or judged, or it doesn't come from that. It doesn't come from love. It comes from that place of judgment, those negative feelings. And there is a place, I believe, that we could get to collectively as men where we... Because it's all reflective too, which I'm sure you've learned in the circles. It's like someone who reacts in that way, they're reacting that way because they're reflecting their feelings about themselves.
Mm. They're just projecting their shit.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. It's like, I mean, I got bullied heavily when I was a kid because I'm a fucking weirdo, right? Mm. And amongst other things.
Mm.
And when I got stronger and taller and that sort of stuff, and... I will admit that I did do a bit of bullying myself in response to my own trauma.
Mm.
But through that, I was like, hang on a minute. I'm only doing this because of what happened to me.
Mm.
That means that it's the trauma that makes you do that. It's not because bullying is cool. It's not because victimization is cool.
You're just projecting your pain onto somebody else.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hurt people hurt people.
Absolutely, man.
You know, and that's just the way it plays out until you become aware of it.
Mm.
And in saying, you know, what you just said then, that, you know, that brotherly love, giving each other shit, I have that same relationship with Neil.
Yeah.
And Neil's program was a big part of my life when I split up with my son's mum.
Okay.
And once again, universe doing its thing, sitting there on Facebook and the ad for his program come up, the Black Dog Brotherhood.
Yeah.
So, I'll check this out. Booked myself in for a call, had the call with him. and started his program.
Oh, it's valuable. It's such valuable work that he does, man. It's you know, you've said a lot about PTSD and depression and trauma tonight, and you know, having the perspective, it's like I have my own set of traumas. However, comparatively, nothing to some of the stuff that you went through. Yet at the same time, it's the same triggers. It's the same chemical response.
It's all relative, man.
Yeah.
It's all relative.
Your existence is your existence.
You know, I can say that about some of the stories I've heard about guys getting sexually abused. I've never been sexually abused.
Yeah.
And I don't know how the fuck I would handle it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Mm.
My trauma is my trauma. Your trauma is your trauma.
Mm.
You still have the things that trigger you off, and you're still going to have the same responses.
It's the same chemical response to whatever it happens. That's it, man. Like, that's the...
And I mean, some people, and that's, you know, some people have been through like shit loads, man.
Mm.
And from what I know, and from working with the youth that I've worked with, they're the ones that have been through a shit load. And that's why they're in youth detention. They're not in youth detention because their life was rosy growing up, man.
Yeah, that was their choice. That was their path in life, yeah. They didn't choose that. They reacted to this.
It depends. Once again, it depends which way you look at it.
Yeah.
Like, if you believe that you choose your life to come here, you've chosen this life to be here, you've chosen your parents to learn those lessons.
Yeah.
And don't get me wrong, like, that's fucking brutal, man, to choose that style of life.
Especially if you think about some of the more unfortunate people of our society. If you believe that line of thinking, you've chosen that's a harsh, some harsh fucking lessons to learn, man.
Yeah, totally, totally. And as I said, man, they're not in youth detention, and men generally aren't in jails because they had the perfect upbringing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? They've got trauma.
Mm.
They've got deep-seated trauma.
Mm.
You know what I mean? I mean, I had a young woman on one of my programs. She'd been living on the street since she was 13.
Yeah, try and fathom that for a second. Yeah.
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 And now, looking at it, she was probably one of those young girls who was on that Today Tonight program.
Yeah, right.
What style of life, or what style of family life do you have to be in living on the streets at 13?
For that to be a viable option.
To be the best option, man.
Yeah.
And, see that, and yeah, then
it's doing that is better than what you had.
Yeah. And then being introduced to the pipe.
Yep.
And then.
Yeah, fuck, man. Ice is such a scourge, you know. Like, it's. Yeah.
Man, I was on it for nearly four years.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I've watched documentaries after I got off it and got clean. And I know why. I really understand now why it's so addictive.
Mm.
If you're living down here, like, you're in deep depression, right? Somebody gives you that pipe or, you know, the pick.
Mm.
Pick's even, I believe, even more. It's the next level.
Yeah.
They give you that pipe and they've said, the documentary said, it's releasing the same amount of endorphins into your brain. Or actually 100 times more endorphins into your brain than when you orgasm.
Wow. Okay. Right. And
That's the high.
Fucking hell.
Now, you think about it, man. Out of all the deep, dark places that you've been in, I know where I've been, and most of the guys on this podcast would know where they've been.
Yeah.
If you're in that dark space and somebody hands you that, and you've got the trauma you're dealing with, all you want to do is just tap out of it for a little while. All I need to do is just give myself a break. I'll tap out. I'll have this. The next thing, you've gone from laying on the floor, metaphorically speaking, to being in the clouds.
Sometimes not metaphorically.
Yeah, being in the clouds.
Yeah. Wow. And then you chase the dragon forever after.
And then it's just that constant chase, man. Mm. And then it's like, that, you know, that addiction. It's like what I've heard you say 100 times before. You don't have that rebound.
Yeah.
That rebound just keeps deeper and deeper and deeper. So then you want to tap out even more and more and more.
Yeah, that's right. Because the come down's worse than what you've experienced. So it's like, to get out of this, I'll go again.
And then on top of that, if you've really got out there when you're on it, you start getting flashbacks. And that was what I was getting when I got clean.
Right.
Start getting flashbacks. And for me, I was dreaming about it. I was dreaming
about getting high,
sitting there with watching the flame under the bowl. That's what I was dreaming about. Or I'd have a dream, I'd walk into a party and the table would just be like covered in a mound of ice.
It pervades your consciousness in at a subconscious level.
Mm. So not only are you going through withdrawals, but you're dreaming about it. So the first thing from, I have to say I own my statements, own my story. I was dreaming about it. So the first thing I was thinking about when I woke up was what?
Yeah, you just had a cool dream about being high as fuck.
Yeah.
Fucking hell. Yeah, see, that's the...
And that went on for ages, man. I had, you know, cravings, like full-blown cravings. I think it was about 3 or 4 weeks. 3 months was the next one. 6 months was the next one. And I remember the last hardcore craving was around about 12 months.
Yeah, right.
Off it.
Fucking hell. Yeah, man. It's hard to... Like I've shared the story on the podcast before. Like I watched a mate of mine. One guy killed himself and another guy OD'd off hard drugs. Mm. So fortunately, I never did. I just, because of that, I had no interest. Mm. It was such a negative connotation and association with it that I didn't care how high you got. I was not going to go there.
Yeah.
But I've seen so many people and so many, you know, one of my ex-girlfriends nearly fucking killed herself on it. Like she was full blown on it.
Mm.
And so many other boys just slave to the rock, you know?
Yeah,
I mean?
Well, a mate of mine that I grew up with died of a heroin overdose when I was nomming for the club.
Yeah.
Yeah. One of his girlfriends introduced it to him and bumped into him one night up at the Cross and he was like full blown, like...
Full junkie mode.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And he spotted me and I was standing there with... You know, half a dozen members standing there behind me were just hanging out and he spotted me and walked up and like they realized that he was like sussing me out.
Mm.
I ended up just grabbing him and walking him up the road and I said, man, what the fuck? Have a go at you.
Yeah.
You know, and I said to him, mate, I said, do you realize who I'm with and all that sort of stuff? Like, mate, one, have a look at yourself. You need to get yourself off the shit and massively hypocritical. I was where I was.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? But I was just like, mate, you need to get yourself sorted, man, and don't ever come up here again.
Yeah, because I don't take kindly to that sort of shit.
And I said to him, if I ever see you again like this, I'm going to take you home to your mum, man, and I'm going to make her sit down and listen to what I've got to tell her about where you're at.
Yeah.
And the next time I saw him, he, you know, lied to me and told me that he was clean. You know, he was banging it up through his toes instead of his arms.
So didn't have the visible tracks.
Didn't have fresh track marks.
Yeah.
And it was only a short while after that I got a phone call. So they found him. He'd been in a car, in his car with the windows up in the back streets of the Cross for 3 days in 40 degree heat. Summer heat. Jesus. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, look, and I suppose... To sort of counteract some of the darkness that we're in at the moment, the men's circles and, you know, for me, a lot of it is this room, mate. You know, a lot of it's in here exploring ideas and, you know, sometimes on the mic, sometimes not on the mic.
Yeah.
And having that space. But I think there's such an underlying trauma with men in general stemming... And I think what it really, it's interesting, it was only a little while ago, I love Dan Carlin, Hardcore History, and he's currently doing, he only does one podcast every 6 months, but they're fucking epic. Like, that's the best history podcast going around. Do you listen to him?
No.
Oh, you got to get on that.
Mm-hmm.
However, what he was describing, because World War II is so glorified. It was the good war, it was the all that stuff, right?
Mm.
And look, it probably was. There was some evil that was going to try and take over the world and we had to stop it. However, the things that those boys saw, right? I mean, it really struck home to me that when they were fighting the Japanese through the Pacific Islands, that they couldn't land the boats for the bodies and that the sea was literally red with blood.
Mm.
And that is our fathers that had that trauma, you know, and their fathers lived through World War One, then the Depression, then World War Two, and that is,
and then you got Vietnam,
and then you got the jungle, then you got the jungle war, which where, you know, a lot of drugs and everything through there, and you've got these men that we are descendants of had such a fucking level of trauma that we can't even understand it. And that's why a lot of these boys didn't talk when they came back, because there's no reference point. How do you talk to your wife about the sea of your mates that you had to swim through?
Yeah.
You know, like how can you even begin to put that into words?
Once again, it's that mentality of bury it and it'll go away.
Yeah. Bottle it up.
Oh, yeah, bottle it up, suppress it, do whatever, and usually it comes out sideways. It's only a matter of time before it comes out sideways, and so they start suppressing it with alcohol, drugs, whatever.
Yeah.
But, Neil and I went to the first circle together, first time we went to Mankind Project together.
Yep.
And for me, it's been a game changer.
Like, and so where are those guys, the Mankind Project?
They're actually in 17 countries throughout the world.
Okay.
Yeah. I go to, a handful around Brisbane area, one down the Gold Coast.
Yeah.
So I alternate, generally go 1 week or whatever, one up in Cannon Hill, go to the other one down the Gold Coast. It's different energies, each one.
Yeah, different. And so explain to me what, as much as you can, obviously I don't need to know any details because what stays in the circle stays in the circle.
It's sacred. It's not secret.
Okay.
And that's what we say. It's sacred, but it's not secret. Respect it.
Yeah.
Respect that a man's up there doing his work. You don't talk about who it was and what he was doing. You talk about what I got out of brother doing his
that
work.
Perspective.
The piece I took out of what he was doing in his work.
Yeah.
And then, you know, what I get out of standing up and doing my work. And plus going away for the weekend as well.
Well, mate, make sure that when we release this one, you give me some details and links and stuff, and I'll put those in the show notes, because there could be some gentlemen here that are listening. And if it's in 17 countries around the world, obviously this is a global podcast as well, so there will be guys out there that
that's
interesting, man. That's very interesting stuff. And look, that is something that we talked about ad nauseum at Amart over many lunches. Was about lack of ritual and lack of circle, you know.
Yeah.
And I think we are blessed insofar as, you know, with all the chaos that's going on and all the unbelievable stuff that's going on around us at the moment. At the same time, those men that are attempting to do the work, it's becoming less of a stigma every day. Unfortunately, still the most common cause of death for men between 18 and 55 is suicide day. And it's probably gone up over the last 14 months due to COVID because of the amount of men that lost their purpose because their work is their purpose.
Yeah.
And however, at least there does seem to be less of a stigma. Would you agree with that?
It's becoming more talkable, I suppose. The conversations are a lot more.
It's more acceptable.
It's more acceptable, but the guys are still suppressing, you know what I mean? For a majority of them are. And that's what another part of the program that I'm working on, getting men's circles into jails.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, my theory is if we're not working on the extreme end of men and young men, obviously with the farm program into youth detention, working with those guys to work through their stuff and create positive outcomes for them, then
it's the reverberation through the community.
Well, that's where society is.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? It's all good and well to be, you know, working with the guys who have already gone through that process and they're still dealing with their stuff, don't get me wrong. But the ones that are in the deepest, darkest holes.
With no resources, no real...
And have no way of knowing how to get out of it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I've been there. I know exactly where it's at.
As you said before, it's all relative, isn't it, mate? If that is your existence and that has been your existence since you were a child because you were born into a domestic violence situation or whatever it is, pick the trauma.
Yeah.
You don't have a reference point. You don't have that... You know, you talk about the rebound. You don't have that reference point to build your base off because there's nothing there.
Yeah.
It's been nothing but darkness and God only knows what, you know.
And it's, you know, like sitting in circle, it's understanding, you know, what's driving your shadow or my shadow. you know, what's driving those behaviors, why these things keep coming up in our lives, and understanding that, you know, it's come from something that's happened more, you know, every time from the childhood. You know, if I've taken on, I'm not good enough, I'm not lovable, I'm not worthy, and that plays out. Even when you get something good in your life, your subconscious is running those stories.
Yeah.
And I know that I've self-sabotaged.
Yeah.
Because I'm feeding that, I'm allowing that shadow to take control.
Yeah. What's fascinating to me, Duncan, is that the pattern repeats itself and repeats itself and repeats itself, right? Because I know I've suffered from self-worth and personal sabotage and not being good enough and not ever thinking I'm doing anything I'm doing is good enough and all of those things. What I wanted to ask you about is when you work with these guys, because one of the things that I've identified through my teaching, and obviously it's been a long time since you've been in my classroom, and I've evolved all my ideas and worked through them since then, is the underlying rage that I see that I had, and I say had, I don't anymore, thank fuck. However, that was, you know, we might get into some shadow stories in a minute. However, how are you helping these boys with that? Is it just through conversation or physical activity?
It's funny you say that, because I was at a workshop or whatever you want to call it, a night, not long ago, and one of the guys that I was at that circle the first few weeks that I went, first started going, and, you know, those first few weeks, I couldn't even get out a sentence. And this was just after I split, or was in the process of splitting, and just after I split with my son's mum. Those first few weeks, I couldn't even get out a sentence without just breaking down.
Yeah.
Just absolutely devastatingly breaking down.
Yeah. Because you'd failed again, basically.
Just, yeah, everything. The pain of not seeing my son. The pain of, yeah, no, in my head, I'd failed again. I'd fucked it up again. Yeah. Here we are again.
You know what I mean? Same old, same old.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You're fucking not worth it. What the fuck have you done now?
Yeah, yeah. And it's just, yeah, beating myself up.
Yeah.
Beating myself up. And just having that conversation with them. And as I said, I started off really all the time with, righto, this is where I've been. This is what's happened to me. Blah, 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 blah. This is where I'm at. This is what's helped me change. And this is how I'm showing up now. And one of the biggest things that hit home, well, one of the real aha moments in circle was when one of the facilitators was saying, he was working on another dude doing a process, and he said, are you the type of man that you would be happy to see your daughter fall in love with?
Boom.
And are you the type of man that you would be proud to see your son grow into?
Yeah.
Or to become, I should say.
Yeah.
And it was just like, fuck.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And it was, and they're partly the reasons why I split with my partners. It was like, I didn't want my kids thinking this was a standard relationship.
Yeah,
this is why it plays out.
Yeah.
You know, and it was just like, yeah, that was one of the proverbial baseball bats.
Yeah.
It's just like, Rightio, now what have I got to do?
Yeah, what have I got to do to change my
perception?
What
have I got to do to show up as the best version of myself, to show my girls the type of man that they need to, that they, you know, would be happy seeing them with?
Yeah.
And how am I showing up, or what do I need to do to show up as the best version of me, to have the relationship and have a better relationship, as in communication and expressing my love for my son and my girls, obviously, than what I had with my father.
Yeah.
My father showed his love in his ways, and I didn't know it until I worked it out later on in my life.
Sure.
But how do I evolve on that and show up as the best version of myself for my kids?
That's the question.
How do I create that safe haven in my house that my kids know that they can come there, it's peaceful, they can talk to me about whatever's going on for them. You know, I'm not going to lose my shit. I might get angry and afterwards, I have done this. I've, you know, got angry and then I've walked in and said, listen, I shouldn't have yelled at you. I got upset. Rightio, now how,
These are the reasons I got upset, and this is the, what we're trying to
this
work
is
through.
This is what was going through my mind, and this is how I really feel. Mm. That was my reaction, but this is how I really feel. Mm. I'm worried. I'm upset.
Mm.
You know, how do we, you know, this is how I feel we need to, you know, and have that discussion.
Yeah.
And I heard that on, you know, Triple M interview, or, you know, a guy rang up and said his son's been in and out of youth detention, blah, blah, blah. He doesn't know what to do. He's at the end of his, you know, rope, rah, 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 rah.
Mm.
And it actually came out of his mouth. It's like, oh, no, we don't have that conversation. It's too painful.
Yeah.
That's where it is, brother.
Mm. Communication.
That's no matter how messy it is, to sit there with your child and have that conversation and open myself, yourself, ourselves up to showing that emotion. If we cry, we cry in front of our child.
Mm, that's okay.
But show them that emotion.
That it's okay to experience that.
But also the fact that it's coming from a space of love and a space of caring.
Mm.
And it's showing them that vulnerability.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and just saying, this is where I'm at with this situation. Mm. I love you. I don't know what to do. And it's okay to say I don't know what to do.
Mm. Yeah, you don't have to know. You don't have to have the answers all the time, I think. You know, there's something in there where, as men, we are problem solvers.
Mm.
I've got it. Don't even fucking worry about it. I've got it. I'll fix the problem. I've got it.
Mm.
Sometimes you don't got it.
Mm.
Sometimes you got shit.
Mm.
You got nothing.
And that's okay.
Yeah. How do you, you know, and you would have heard it on the podcast 1,000 times, that you, the only thing that you need to know is you know nothing, regardless of what you do actually know.
Mm.
You know nothing.
Mm.
And as long as you can truly grasp and understand that, not saying that what you know isn't valuable, however, in the grand scheme of things, it's nothing.
And then you've got your blind spots.
Yeah.
So you don't know what you don't know.
That's right. That's right. You know? Yeah, look, that was a big thing. I know one of the epiphanies I had with my parents, and I had a conversation with them, and I remember... I basically confronted them, and I went round there with a whole big plan and of what I was going to say. But halfway over there, the universe delivered the chestnut. They don't know what they don't know.
Mm.
You were actually very good at hiding everything, you dickhead.
Mm.
So how do they know? They don't actually fucking know.
Mm.
They don't know what they don't know.
Yeah.
And as long as we can get in deep and explore those things, you know, and the rage, I think, comes from a place of pain, don't you think?
Oh, totally.
Yeah.
Totally.
It's not...
A pain on different levels as well.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that when I realized my rage was not anger, it was pain, and it was trauma, and it was...
And it was also, for me, it was anger at myself.
Mostly, because we know when we fuck up.
Mm.
Sometimes we just don't have the balls to admit it.
And that's also sitting in circle. It's, you know, you're being held accountable by being held accountable and learning to be integrous within yourself and owning that.
Mm.
And owning them when you fuck it up. Mm. Or you make a mistake. Mm-hmm. Stand up.
Mm-hmm.
Being held accountable by other healthy men. Mm-hmm. Other men that are doing their work.
Mm.
Not being judged or being ridiculed.
No.
Just going, hey man, you said you were going to do this or blah, blah, blah.
And you didn't.
You didn't. Okay, but why didn't you do it? Let's get to the root of the problem of why you didn't do it.
Yeah, not you fucked up, dickhead.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You made a mistake. Everybody makes mistakes. But why? Let's get to the core root of why.
Mm.
Then when you get to the core root of why, beautiful.
Mm.
I love you.
Mm. Yeah.
I love you.
Mm.
Regardless.
And you know what, man? There's those three words amongst men are not spoken enough. And I've started making a point of my brothers that I speak to on a regular basis saying, I love you, man.
Mm.
And they're like, why are you saying that? I said, I'm saying that because we don't have love for each other.
Mm.
And it's not, the modern society has twisted it from a, you know, love, sex, sells, mm. blah, yeah, blah, yeah, fucking yeah. bullshit. It's got nothing to do with that.
No.
Right? You know, you talk to any of these army boys, the military guys, are they fighting for their country? Are they fighting for the ideal? No, they're not fucking doing anything. They're fighting for the bloke next to them.
Mm. Yeah.
Because they have love for that guy mm. who's next to them.
Mm.
And that's it.
Yeah.
And we've lost that. We've lost that. We've lost that in the dog eat dog. You know, second is the first loser. And, you know, can't be vulnerable. Don't show weakness.
But and also that too, it's a conditioning as well. You know, like how many times have you heard your father say that he loves you? And I'm not blaming them again. I'm mm-hmm. just saying being aware.
Yeah.
Aware of that conditioning.
Yeah.
And I've been aware that I've had guys say, you know, when on leaving circle, I love you, man. And I can't say it. I choke.
Yeah.
And I just go and sit in the car on the way home. So, why the fuck can't I say it?
Mm.
What is in me that I...
It's conditioning.
Choke, yeah. I choke when I can't, when he says it. Like, and it's not coming from a place of just saying it. And it's the same with the kids. When they say, you know, I love you, it's not just conditioning them just to say it for the sake of saying it.
Mm. Well, the thing about children, especially small children, they're saying it from
mm.
the most purest place that exists.
Yeah, totally. But I've also, from sitting in circle, I also now, when my son says it to her, and it's the best feeling, even with my girls when they were young, there's nothing better than hearing, just randomly, hey, Dad, I love you.
Mm.
It's just like, fuck.
Mm.
Fuck.
Mm.
And now I'm at this stage where my son says that, and I say, thank you, I received that.
Can you say it back yet?
Oh, I say it to him all the time.
Yeah.
Say it to him all the time.
Yeah.
I smother him.
Yeah.
Kisses, hugs, everything, man.
Yeah.
You know, and I know that's me going...
Not overcompensating, but you're trying to break the cycle of what came before.
Yeah. And knowing that he's loved. But it's also saying to him occasionally, or not occasionally, I say it to him a lot, but sometimes I'll say it to him and he goes, I don't.
Cheeky little shit. I don't.
No, but in that moment.
And he probably didn't.
That moment, kids are living on the moment, every moment.
Yes, they are.
They're not like we are when we're, you know, conditioned, we're, you know, stuck in our heads all the time.
Yeah.
They're living in the moment.
In and that moment, he probably didn't.
And at that, yeah, he didn't.
Yeah.
He just might be pissed at me or something or whatever. He's just, I'm not feeling it at the moment.
Yeah. Didn't give him a juice box or something. Yeah, yeah. Don't love you anymore.
Yeah. 5 minutes later, though.
Yeah.
It's, hey, Dad, I love you. Yeah. And it's just like,
it's okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, mad.
And love is the answer, Duncan. However, you've got to be ready to receive it, right?
Yeah, and there's an additive to that, man. Love is the answer. But it's like one of the interviewers said to me on Triple M, oh, so they just need a big cuddle about these young people in youth detention. And it was like, yeah, you're coming at it from that angle and I can see what angle you're saying.
It's a bit of a loaded question.
But yes, they need that, but they also need to understand boundaries. Mm. They also need to understand there's consequences. Yeah. And but healthy discipline.
Absolutely.
There's a big difference between discipline and abuse.
Well, you know, I think that was, when we first met, that was the beginning of my understanding of discipline and the fact that we grew up, you know, we were the last generation that got the cane at school and stuff like that. Like,
I never got the cane. I was lucky.
Did you? When I was like five, I think it was ruled out when I was like seven, but it was around. I remember I got wrapped on the left hand.
Yeah, yeah.
That was discipline, and that's too far, right? However, healthy discipline, and to a point, there's a big yes. Yes, you're obviously very diplomatic. I would have said something pretty nasty when they said they just need a cuddle. However,
well, I'm on air, mate.
You're on actual air, not the refinery air. So it's a different space.
Yeah,
public.
And, and they edited that as well. That was an offline, off-air conversation.
So they snippeted it to.
So they edited it to however they wanted it to, and they cut that conversation basically in half.
Yeah,
from what I'd actually said.
Yeah, right.
And the way that I thought the previous programs hadn't worked and all that sort of stuff. And as I said, she came back with, also they just need a big cuddle. Well, they need to be nurtured.
Mm.
Yes.
I want to unpack that for a second.
Yeah.
And specifically talk about the cuddle, right?
Mm.
So we hadn't seen each other in a long time.
Mm.
We shook hands and had a hug
when
we saw each other because we both know that's healthy thing to do.
Mm.
And that was respect and love, right? How many of these young men and women, for that matter, have actually had positive human contact?
Well, once again, that's why they are where they are, man.
Yeah.
And if they have had some human contact, you know, worst case scenario, it's been sexual abuse.
Mm.
It's been whatever.
Mm.
It's been physical abuse.
Mm.
And you can rattle off the list of things.
That it could be.
And that's...
And that's all negative reinforcement. That's not positive reinforcement.
But that's from people that's supposed to love them.
Yeah. So they grew up with a twisted sense of what is real and what is not.
What is it? Their perception of love.
Yeah.
Or what they've been conditioned to understand what love is.
Yeah, yeah. But see, I've been trying to institute with all the boys two things: giving them a hug and saying "love you, man."
Yeah, well, we hug, saying hello and goodbye in circle, and even when we're not in circle, that's just the way it is with those guys.
Yeah,
you know, and you know, pretty much everybody I speak to now, you know, I'm like that shake. Fucking give a hug.
Mm.
I mean, these days you got to ask them. So, you know.
If it's a new person, can I hug you?
Oh, yeah. With all the bullshit going on there too.
Oh, yeah,
are you true. Cool with a hug? You know, are you doing that or you're not? You doing the elbow or the fist pump or whatever bullshit thing it is that's going on at the moment?
It is bullshit.
And that's another topic of conversation completely.
Well, it is, because how is that? If you separate people and they don't have human contact, then they're more easily controlled.
Oh, totally, but we run, humans run on human contact.
Yeah, absolutely. I think they say if a baby, like a brand new baby, if it doesn't have human contact, it'll actually die within 2 weeks.
Well, they had that study back in World War II, I think it was.
Yeah.
That's been proven.
Yeah.
If they don't have any sort of contact, it's only a certain amount of time before they start dying.
Mm. Because it's, that's what they're actually fundamental. That's exactly what they need.
It's an energy thing.
Yeah.
Energy exchange.
Absolutely. Absolutely it is. And they say, I think it's 30, like if you have a decent hug, at some point you actually your energy starts to intertwine.
Mm. I think it's 30 seconds. I think you're around about the right mark there. Yeah.
You know, 30-second hug between blokes might be a bit awkward, but...
But why?
It's true. I was thinking of a story of an experience in PNG where over there culturally those boys hold hands.
Mm.
Like they were like when we were 5 and 6, they held hands, a chain of 5 guys holding hands.
Yeah.
And I remember one of the times, it was a little while after I'd been there, one of the boys went to grab my hand.
Mm.
And I instinctually went, what the fuck are you doing?
Hmm.
And then I had it explained to me that it's a cultural thing.
Yeah.
The fact that they went to grab my hand means that is actually a mark of respect and love and stuff like that. Yeah. And after that, I'll be honest, man, you know, there was times when I'd have 4 of my boys and we're all holding hands walking up the road.
Yeah.
And the guys used to give me shit about it. I'm like, well, hang on a minute. This is their normal. And what is wrong with human contact? How long since you've had a hug, mate?
Hmm.
And that's a quick way to shut blokes up.
Yeah. And in saying that, they're only saying that because of their conditioning.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It was the perception of being gay or whatever bullshit story
you
want to put on it.
Stereotype.
Yeah. Just projected bullshit.
Yeah, it's interesting, man. And look, why? And you're right. Why should a 30-second hug between blokes be a bad thing?
Mm.
It actually probably shouldn't be a bad thing. You know, I think it probably could be very positive. And I wonder if we embraced each other more often, which is what I try to do with the boys that I speak to on a regular basis. When we say, the thing about it is, you know, you'd be the same, mate. Those guys that are hustling and have families and children and stuff, we don't see each other as much as we'd like. You know, I think we've spoken about doing this podcast for the last 18 months or something. Pre-COVID, we were trying to get together, and then COVID hit.
Mm.
And then the last, you know, 4 or 5 months, we've been trying to square up a time. And it's not because we didn't want to do it. It's because we're busy guys. And, you know, like, but we should make time. And that's why I respect what you're doing and your dedication to the circle and stuff like that. Like, I have my own version of things within this space. However, you've got to make that time, don't you? If you're going to get better.
Well, you know, and I'm sure you've heard it before, and I'm sure plenty of other people heard it. You can't help from an empty cup.
True.
You can't do anything from an empty cup.
Yeah, that's true.
If you're not taking the time out to do something that is for you,
mm-hmm.
and to fill up that cup, mm-hmm. whatever that may be,
mm-hmm.
you know, like, how can you expect to be there for anybody else? It's only going to be a matter of time before you're running on empty. And we all know how that ends.
Absolutely. I seen a member of a bloke talking about passion projects in a small classroom at Amart. You know what I mean? Like, that's, and that was the start of that, you know, and I've kept on with that. And it's interesting. I've had a number of boys since then get in touch with me and go, hey, I've started BMXing again, or I've started doing this again, or I'm doing this now. And that's the thing that they do for themselves.
Mm. Well, my passion project back then was the farm,
The farm program.
I already had that in my head, and I've been chipping away at it, going from the ground level, learning from the ground level up.
Mm.
And I've had 5-6 years of no's, or 5 or 6 years of, yeah, love the idea, fantastic idea. When it's up and running, let me know.
Yeah.
It's like, I'm not going to need you when it's up and running.
Yeah, I need your help.
What I need is to get the support on the ground level, build it, build something together that is going to create massive change.
Mm.
And in the end, we reduce the men in jail, we reduce recidivism. Along with that comes reduced drug use, drug addictions, reduced suicide, reduced domestic violence, fathers being there for their sons and their daughters in healthy ways.
Yep.
Fathers being there for their families, fathers and men being there for their community.
Mm.
How is that not an overall win-win?
Mm. So what is it? So obviously I helped you with some of the documentation back in the early days and gave you some advice on how to write it and present it and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Where does it sit now? Obviously you are still working with Youth Justice now.
No, I'm actually working for Access Community Services.
Yep.
I'm a case manager for a pilot program. I'm working with ex-gang members, men disassociating from gang life, supporting them into mental health services, mentoring, employment. I offer them to go to men, you know, there's men's circles here and there, and it's been a game changer for me.
Mm-hmm.
There's issues there that I sort of won't get into
here. Yeah, that's fine. No.
But I have said from the start of this program, the way I feel to make this program 100%, or not 100%, but a lot more successful, or a lot more thing, is to get men's circles into jails.
Yeah.
So you're working with the men before they transition out.
Yeah, that they have a perspective as they are transitioning out. They have a perspective. They have a rough plan.
They get a greater understanding as to what the pattern of behavior is that got them there in the first place.
So they don't get out and repeat themselves.
So when they come out, but also that they've got circles that they can go and tap into on a weekly basis and keep that process going.
Because is it basically mainly religious based now in the prisons, or is that where is it at now?
I do know, and I have had meetings with a guy who is an ex-gang member who turned to Islam, and he's doing work in there, but obviously with his Muslim brothers.
A religious connotation
attached
to it.
Yeah, and from my understanding, what's in there now is like AA or NA, but it's run through the chapel.
Yeah. So, yeah, so it's the 12-step program or whatever it is, but from, run through.
Yeah, from my understanding, it's run through the chapel. And there's no reason why this program can't be run through the chapel. It's not, it's a, like, I guess on some level you could say it's a like a spiritual, holistic
could be, yeah, approach. Absolutely, yep.
Approach, but just because it doesn't fit under the terminology of religion.
Yeah.
Or, you know, the Catholic belief or whatever it is, doesn't mean to say. And in saying that too, they've been running programs similar to this over in Folsom and San Quentin for a few years now, and they've had amazing results.
Yeah.
It wasn't long ago that they actually, up until just recently, they had a documentary on YouTube called The Work.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody that I've spoken to that saw that documentary was just blown away by it.
Yeah.
Absolutely blown away by it.
Yeah.
And that's the stuff that I want to take into jails for men.
Yeah.
And as I said, the farm program for youth to get them out of the jail cells, get them through programs to have a positive outcome.
Yeah.
Create that possibility of having positive outcomes at the end.
Mm.
And so when they come out, they've got a certificate in, you know, conservation land management, construction, small motors, small engines, something along those lines, as well as doing
engineering, warehousing, whatever it is.
You'd probably be able to have to limit it to an extent.
Yeah.
But they've still got those.
The program.
Some sort of skills, yeah, and some sort of certificate at the end of the 6-month program.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of sending them in for a month and locking them up for a month, putting trauma on top of more trauma, letting them out and expecting them to change just like that, mm-hmm. just because they've been let out.
Mm.
Put them on the farm program for 6 months, give them counseling, give them food and nutrition, and understanding of that, how, you know, healthy nutrition affects your gut, your mind, and the rest of your body, how all that is interconnected.
Yeah.
Get them connected into, you know, boxing, Muay Thai.
Physical activity.
BJJ.
Yeah.
Which is discipline, focus, self-love, respect, respect the all gym, respect your trainers, respect your fellow mates that are there.
Mm.
You know, then on top of that.
So the idea has evolved, mate, since the last time we spoke about
it. Massively.
Yeah.
Massively. And then, as I said, since I've sat in circle, I can see the benefit of sitting in circle, the way that, you know, Mankind Project do it. And I mean, don't get me wrong, there's other circles out there that are very similar. And how that can have such a positive effect for men inside to help them transition out.
It makes total sense to me. I can only see it being a benefit. You know, I've had, I'm going to say a number, but I've had a fair few students over the years be ex-gang members, ex-prison, that sort of stuff.
Mm.
And what I've found, I've taken the time with most of the guys that came to me and asked for help, I've stayed back with them and we've had conversations. And the big thing that I've got from them is that, as we've spoken about before, as we spoke about tonight, should I say, it's their narrative.
Hmm.
And, you know, what I said, I'm like, listen, man, you don't have to be part of that narrative anymore. If you truly want to change, you don't have to be part of that narrative. You can choose not to be. However, if you could start, you know, these are guys that have been out for X amount of time and are still struggling not to go back in.
Hmm.
If you could approach that from that perspective inside, and then do you think, like, this farm project that you're talking about, would you maybe transition them out of prison to there for a little while and then go from there? Or is that, or do you want to replace some of the detention instead of going to detention for the 10th time?
Wouldn't get that far.
Yeah.
What the way the farm program for youth detention, how I envision it is, the magistrates are referring them to that.
Sure.
They've come up in the front of the magistrate for, you know, second or third time, third strike, you're
third
out.
Third strike.
Unless it's something serious.
Yep.
And then it's rightio, you go into this program for 6 months. You've had your opportunities, like, to change your behavior. And in saying that too, its statistics will show you that majority of young people that come into contact with the law, majority of them, they'll get, you know, come in contact with the law, get a couple of charges, first time offence, and they won't go back. But what it is there's roughly 10%, probably a little bit more now, that are committing 50% of the crime.
Right. Okay.
And it's like that, you know, the young fella that was just recent that brought all this back to the forefront again in the media.
Yeah.
He was out on bail. He was in a stolen vehicle.
That's the one that rolled over in Cleveland.
I think he ran a red light and killed those people. But he was out on bail. You know what I mean? Like, how many times has he been up in that situation? Basically, what the way I see it is, he's screaming for help.
Yeah.
He might not physically.
He might not actually be verbalizing it. However, the actions that he's taking, he is, you know, to be out on bail and the first thing you do is go and commit a crime, that is a plea for help.
And he's 17-year-old looking at what, triple murder because the woman was pregnant.
Yeah.
Or something along those lines.
Yeah.
But yet, his actions were saying,
I need help.
Yeah. Yeah. And my personal opinion is letting him out with GPS trackers isn't going to work. It's been shown when all that stuff happened back in 2019 when the Watch House issue came up into the media, how they were locking the youth up because the detention centres were full. You know,
so they let him out with ankle bracelets and GPS trackers, is that the...
Yeah, well, they were breaking international detention laws by keeping young people in cells, in watch house cells for up to 30 to 40 days. There's even a case of a young girl being put in a cell with two suspected pedophiles.
Jesus.
That's actually in the Four Corners program, Watch House program, that they aired.
Yeah.
Shortly after that, because it got such attention, all the young people were let out. They were even shipping down youngsters or youth from Townsville because the detention center up there was chock-a-block full. So they're flying them down here, locking them up down here, flying them back for their court appearance, then flying them back down here. So they've got no contact with any healthy family whatsoever. At that age, they're being dragged out backwards and forwards, backwards and forwards.
There's no positive outcome there.
No way. I mean, I can't see any positive outcome with that. And I know there's, you know, Indigenous community uncles, elders that want to step forward and that are trying to step forward to help help fix the problem. And letting, as I said, it was shown then that letting them out with GPS trackers didn't work because they all went back. The ones that went back to Townsville went up there and ran amok, and they're still having issues in Townsville now. They don't know how to deal with it. Their solution is putting GPS trackers on them. Half of them know how to get them off anyway.
Yeah, it's only a matter of time. You got an ankle bracelet on, you're going to figure out how to get it off or wherever it is.
Yeah. And I mean, there's documentaries that show it, you know, like, there's a documentary I watched, In My Blood It Runs. It's an Indigenous documentary, and I've watched other ones obviously as well. And it was just, you know, about a young Indigenous fellow that wasn't handling school all that well, and he was playing up and running away and all that sort of stuff. And they ended up sending him up to his father, who was out on country. I think he was even in Northern Territory. And the footage of the change in that young man out on country, doing what was so deeply ingrained in him to do. And it's all, you know, it's also, you know, coming back to the thing where we don't have that initiation.
No.
We don't have that rites of passage anymore.
No.
For young men.
No.
Indigenous cultures have done it for, Jesus, tens of thousands of years.
Hundreds of thousands, yeah.
Yeah. The women hand the young men over to the men in ceremony at, you know, 12, 13, whatever age. There's a big ceremony.
They got to go bush for 2 days and they think they're by themselves. They're not, but they are.
Yeah, or they go up the mountain or whatever with their uncles, their cousins, their older cousins, you know. And generally or not, the father doesn't have anything to do with the son.
In that ceremony.
Back then. Yeah. No, even when they're up on the thing, because at a certain age, it's just genetically ingrained that a boy will start to rebel against his father.
True.
Yeah, at about roughly 14, 15 or something like that.
Yeah.
When the testosterone really kicks in.
Yeah.
But if you surround him with healthy
male mentors. Yeah.
Yeah. And he will choose the mentor that he connects with.
Yeah.
And if you only surround him with unhealthy options, what's the outcome?
There is no healthy outcome there, is
there? If you surround him with healthy options, he's going to choose the one he best connects with.
Mm.
And you've got more of a chance of there being a positive outcome at the end of it.
So where's the farm program at now, mate? Still?
Just finishing off a business plan, and I'm pitching it to different organisations. Reaching out to ministers at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to get or working on getting meetings happening, sitting in front of them and saying, rightio, this is where I believe the system is at.
Mm.
And this is what I believe is going to work. It's a matter of, for me personally, I believe getting as much collaboration from organisations as possible.
Mm.
Like, once again, it takes a community to raise a child.
Absolutely.
If we're not all on board and we're not all
what's the point?
Working together,
yeah.
Then everybody's going to be doing their own thing, which is what my personal opinion,
mm-hmm.
has been doing their own thing and it working to an extent. But once again, that 10 to 15% are still slipping through the cracks,
mm.
or they're not getting what they need.
Well, look, mate, I mean, I did some, so I've got qualifications now to deliver foundation skills.
Mm.
It's a government initiative to address the foundation skills shortage that have not only the youth but the adults. It's something, there's some ridiculous number, like 40% of adults in this country, via some scale, are deemed to be illiterate.
Mm.
Now, you know, we are living in a broken world with broken systems.
Mm.
And I was shocked at that number. Think about that, 40%,
mm.
you know, would be deemed illiterate. The system is failing these young people, both men and women, or boys and girls, I would probably say,
mm.
at such a young age. How do they, and a lot of these, I mean, I've seen it in my class, mate. These guys can barely write their name,
mm-hmm.
but you look into their background and they passed year 12. How is that fucking possible?
Mm. Well, I have that issue with my younger daughter. She's just started high school. She was diagnosed with ADHD and they said she's on the verge of ODD. She was behind in primary school. I got to a point, we changed schools when I split up. She changed schools when I split up. Oh, no, sorry. She started at a primary school when I split up with her mother. And she was behind for whatever reason it was. And I basically begged the school to repeat her so she could go back and try and get a better grasp on that year. And they don't repeat them anymore.
Right.
It's against policy.
They keep pushing them.
They keep pushing them. So now she's going into high school and she's two and a half years behind.
See, what's that going to do in a high school scenario like that?
What's that going to do for the rest of her life?
Exactly.
Their argument was, if you repeat them, it affects their self-confidence. I said to her, you're taking her out of class just about for every class. Don't you think that she realizes that she's not at that same level?
Mm.
Don't you think that's affecting her
mental health, her state of mind,
her self-confidence already? Nah, it doesn't. We'll just keep going, push. And I think it's a money thing. The government don't want to pay those extra years for the kids to go through school. I just keep pushing them.
So it's not about education?
No. That's the way I see it.
Yeah, it's your perspective.
Well, I mean, you have a look at it. If you think there's however many kids in every primary school or every high school that aren't doing and they repeat throughout the state.
Mm. How many kids is that? How much cost is that? Da, 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 da.
What is that up to in dollar signs?
Mm.
And that's the way sometimes it's seen.
the modern society. He works on the mighty dollar, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's so like, you know, I'm not seeing you're dealing with one end of society. However, you know, majority of my students are 19. That, you know, through the SQW programs, are 19 to 25, disengaged young blokes. Mm. You know, and it's interesting to observe after 8 weeks with me. Like, that's the program I run now, so it's not the 2 or 3 days. It's like,
yeah,
I've got these guys for 8 weeks, and we run through, and, you know, there's a lot of personal development, there's a lot of all this stuff. And it's interesting to see the narrative still play out, that even after 8 weeks of positivity and gaining multiple qualifications and ABC, XYZ, these guys still go back to what they know. Some of them don't. Mm. More than a few don't. However, at the same time, this narrative that they seem to be stuck in is affecting them on a visceral self-worth level.
Yeah, and of course, man. Like, you think about it, at 8 weeks isn't going to completely change, what, 10, 20 years of conditioning?
Absolutely.
And I'm not saying, by any means, shape, or form, that those programs aren't having an effect and a positive effect, because I've run those programs and I've seen the positive effect.
Yeah, me too. Yeah,
I've seen the positive effect that it has.
Mm.
But there needs to be a follow-on.
Mm. That's the issue. Like, I've had a few of my guys that were stars in my program.
Mm.
They were leaders. They were doing this. They were doing that. You know, and I would follow them up and, what are you doing? Nothing.
Mm.
So, well, you know.
Yeah.
But it's a hard one, because you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it drink.
That's exactly it.
You know, at some point, these boys and girls from these situations, whilst they do need assistance, and whilst a situation like the farm program and all these sorts of things would greatly help, at the end of the day, if they don't truly want to help themselves, there's not a lot we can do.
Yeah, I mean, you're always going to have that percentage that you're not going to reach.
Yeah.
That's just the law of averages, or whatever you want to put it down to.
Mm.
But my personal opinion is, you've got to create that and allow that possibility to happen.
Yes.
If it's not there, then they can't do it.
True. That's true.
You know what I mean? If there's
no option for them to take, how can they actually take it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, look, that's true. That is very true.
You know what I mean? And, yeah, I mean, I had one young fella showed up every day for his program, like when the Indigenous program ran. Showed up every day. Was a hard worker. He was telling the other boys, pull your heads in, get off your ass, let's, you know, do what we've got to do, blah, blah, blah. Walked out, got out, finished that program. We lined him up with an awesome job with a big construction company. And he went out and started earning good money,
mm-hmm.
going back to a bad household.
Didn't last, obviously.
No.
No.
No. He had it all, but the home environment that he was going back to, and I've seen it with these young fellas, you know, like, you can be, you know, a couple of months into the program, and then they'll go home one weekend, and they'll come back, and something, and you know straight away. As soon as you pick them up on the Monday morning, man, then, I mean, you'd know it yourself.
Absolutely.
The energy is completely different.
Yeah.
And it's like you're back past where you started with them.
That rebound effect.
Yeah, because something's going on at home. And that's part of the farm program as well, is having...
Get them away from that environment.
But, yeah, get them away from that environment, but also have the ability to have a house there on site, on the farm, where the family can come see their child for that weekend and go through the option of starting relationship counseling or family counseling.
Yeah.
So they can start to rebuild that family unit.
And I think, you know, the farm stay stuff would be a neutral environment as well.
Yeah, well, I mean, you'd have a live-in counselor with them for that weekend and be, you know, not hardcore, you know, deep diving counselling for 2 days.
But just be observing and...
And working on it. Mm. Sitting down and showing them a positive way to communicate and what needs to happen.
Mm.
You know, and giving them that opportunity to have and to come and see their child
yeah.
in a healthy environment
yeah.
and create that initiate that process
mm.
of creating a healthy family dynamic.
Yeah.
When the child comes out, they can go and still tap into services that are out there anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Those services already exist.
Mm-hmm.
They choose to go on, but if it doesn't work that way, then they can go out and go into
an alternate option.
They can go into the organisations that are already running now to give them that wraparound support.
Yeah, and there's plenty of those.
Yeah, they're everywhere, and there's that option. That if that option isn't viable or it's just never going to happen, then they can go back out into society, have a job lined up. Where they can upskill to the next certificate or go into an apprenticeship or mm-hmm. whatever, because they have those foundations there set, and tap into the organisations like the Benevolent Society, the Lives Live Well, YFSs, you can rattle them all off.
Yeah.
And those organisations are already set up to deal and work with those youth and have the youth workers there, have the support there mm. and have those mentors still showing up for them.
And look, I think... So a couple of things there, man. I'm super proud of you because I know where the idea started.
Mm.
I saw the first bit of paper that you put together and I know how far it's come. And you need to be proud of yourself that you've stuck with it and making sure that you're still pushing, you're still hustling to try and get it off the ground. I would implore you to... have a passion project separate to that and do something just for you.
Yeah, I do.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do. I'm getting back into surfing.
Okay, good. Good. Second thing is, I think...
And Muay Thai. I'm back, started back training.
Good.
I got my daughter into Muay Thai and I'm going back to Muay Thai as well.
Good.
So, good. Yeah, I definitely... And as I said, I'm very well aware of having... And I just spoke about it before, about filling up my cup.
Yeah.
You know, and the other things that I do within the community that I'm in now.
Because a lot of what you do, mate, is very stressful. Like the people that you're dealing with, I know you've come from that world and this is who you're engaging with,
mm.
but you've got to just be aware of the energy you're investing.
Oh, totally.
And be conscious of that.
Totally. And that was a big learning curve for me for the first 5 years. That was a big learning curve.
Just giving it all. Just giving everything.
Yeah, almost. not setting up boundaries not for regulating. Myself.
Yeah.
Not setting up boundaries for myself and my energy and for my well-being.
Sure.
And that took its toll.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Well, it will. There's only... Look, I learned the same thing, mate. When I first started teaching, I was like, I'll give every single student everything that I've got.
Mm.
I've got a wife and kids at home.
That's it.
Yeah. I've got me.
Yeah.
You know, I've got whatever. Like, you've got to... The cup analogy is good, but you got to have multiple cups, you know, and you've got to be aware of your energy. And I'm very, like, where the idea is now, I'm totally on board with it. And I hope and pray that some rich benefactor listens to this and goes, hey, that's a good idea. Let's get it off the ground. Or, you know, provides the land. Or
well, there's the like you know, that, there's, you know. I mean, it, once I get it up and running, and my vision is to get government funding or funding and get the support of these organisations to get it up and actually get it into youth detention and hopefully get the government's backing for it.
Mm.
Then start reaching out to private investors, the anthropologists. I can't say it. I can never get that word out.
Oh, the, now I can't say the bloody word. The people who donate their money to worthy causes.
Yeah.
Philanthropists.
That's the one.
Yeah.
Yeah, those, and tap into those so I'm not at the whim of the government.
Yes.
Every 4 years.
Because that's the issue.
Yeah. When somebody else comes in. And to be quite honest, I actually reached out to MPs up in the north and down here when all that stuff happened in 2019.
Yep.
Sent them my proposal to MPs on both sides.
Mm-hmm.
And funnily enough, the opposition leader for the Queensland government came up with a hard yakka farm program leading into the election.
Oh. Yeah, good reward and recognition. Thanks, mate. Jesus fuck.
Yeah, I actually messaged one of their MPs and said, hey, funnily enough, that program looks really familiar. And
no response.
I did. I said, oh, yeah, well, can you tell us more? We'd like to know more. And I went,
no.
You've just shown your colours already.
Yeah, that's right. I'm not. You've read half the proposal and gone, oh, this is a good idea. We need more detail to fill it in.
I'll put my spin on it. Yeah. They'll put their spin on it and try and get it through as an election
promise. Or whatever it is.
And I just
which is all bullshit anyway.
Yeah, and I just went, well, no, you know, you hadn't had what, nearly an 18-month time period that you had my email address and my phone number that you could have contacted me and got hold of me to sit down and have meetings and work forward together on this.
Yeah.
And you chose not to. You showed the way that you were going to roll. Mm. I'll just hold back with what I've got at the moment until I have
a solid plan to put in place.
Oh, not so much a solid plan, but what I feel is in a healthy invested interest from the right people.
Mm-hmm. Man, that's awesome stuff. Well, dude, we should probably wrap it up. Mm-hmm. Anything you wanted to finish on, and is there any topics or anything we haven't covered so far? You know, I've really enjoyed this, mate, and I think we've opened up a number of rabbit holes here that we'll come back around again and sit down again to explore this as. Because what will happen over the next few days is that I'm going to percolate and you're going to percolate and there's going to be things that we didn't say that we wanted to say. So we'll come back around. However, for this time, is there anything else you wanted to discuss? Any questions you had for me? Anything else you wanted to discuss before we wrap it up?
Nah. It's just I'd like to put it out there that if there's people out there that have people in high places in construction companies or big organizations or whatever, you know, like have a word to them. Even have a word to them and say, hey, listen, we might be able to help society as a whole here.
Yeah.
You know, like there's an opportunity to jump on board onto this program that's going to create massive, massive change.
Well, make sure you give me all the email details and whatever I can do to assist in getting the word out there, I'll definitely do it for you, man.
Yep.
I don't have an issue.
Yeah.
Now, look, we did want to talk Shadow Path, but I just had an interesting idea that I'll say on the air. Me, you, and the coach.
Yeah.
Tripod.
Yeah, that'd be amazing.
I reckon that could be a very fascinating tripod conversation where we could deep dive. And I know we don't have to talk Neil into much. He's on board.
Yeah.
And now we've said it. Now
he loves to talk.
Yeah, exactly. Getting him to shut up is a problem.
Yeah, that's it.
But no, look, I'll have a chat to him, and maybe we do get together and get deep and share some of the shadow work that we've done, because I think one of the things I've got out of what you said tonight, and there's a few things that are reiterating in my head, is that sharing your own personal story, and I really appreciate you taking the time to share your story tonight. I know sharing my personal story, it still isn't easy. I can do it. However, it doesn't make it any easier. You know, through sharing our own personal journeys and stories, that's what really affects the other men out there and the listeners out there, mate, without a shadow of a doubt. So do you have anything else you wanted to say, mate?
No, just I appreciate the time and the opportunity to come in here and talk about it.
No, man, it's been really good. It's been a really positive conversation.
I agree with what you're saying. Like, the more I talk about my story, it gives other people the permission. It gives them the permission slip to feel into what's going on for them and to maybe step up and change what they need to change in their lives to have a better outcome for themselves and for the people around them.
Absolutely, mate. Now, listen, you're going to get a privilege because in the bookcase there...
I've heard about this.
You've heard about that? In the bookcase there, there's three Warrior books, man. You can see them next to the Ned Kelly book. You can see Warrior Way of the Warriorhood, Warrior Lifestyle, I think it is. There's three books there. Do you see them there in the middle? in the middle.
Warrior Wisdom.
That's the one, obviously. Yeah. So great. So do the yoga twist, mate. Grab the Warrior Wisdom book.
Yep.
Okay. So what? Bring the mic back over to yourself, mate.
Yep.
And what I need you to do is close your eyes, and let's see what the Warrior books have got for us tonight, mate.
Right.
You didn't bring your glasses.
I didn't bring it. That's still a bad habit, eh? Every moment of life is the best. Yeah, every moment of life is the best. And only one who continually re-examines himself and corrects his faults will grow.
Boom. There you go. So you've now experienced that live. That those books, man, I don't know what it is about them.
Yeah.
That's exactly what we've been talking about. And I think just to expand on those two quickly, every moment of life is the best. If you can examine yourself, you can take these moments and you can take moments like we've had tonight and be appreciative of them and enjoy them.
Well, it's actually a message that I've been getting coming through to me, and it's been coming through since last year till I had a few health issues that I've got to start enjoying the journey.
Yes.
Stop being so focused on the end goal.
Spot on.
And focused on what I haven't achieved or what I need to achieve.
Yeah.
Realize and honor myself for what I have achieved.
Absolutely.
And where I've come to now. And that's a big thing for men also.
Absolutely.
Not being able to honor ourselves for where we have come from to where we are now.
Absolutely. Yeah. Look, that's worth expanding on for a second, you know, and I think one of the things that I've really understood is that whatever the next goal is, I'm not saying you shouldn't have targets. You should have targets. You should aim for what you want to aim for. Mm. However, at the same time, it's not the end. In fact, there is no end. Hopefully, if you live a satisfying life, you're going to slip off this mortal coil in many, many, many years to come with shit to do and targets to hit.
Well, I mean, you said it already before, the first, you know, time you saw my original, you know, letter and all that for where it is now has evolved.
Oh, unbelievably so.
Probably pivoted a few times from when
I remember sitting there and asking you questions about what are you going to do, how are you going to do it, what's this thing. You've got answers for all that stuff now.
Mm.
You didn't have answers for that stuff back then,
yeah,
right? So you have achieved. And I am proud of what you've done, man. To come from the guy I met at Amart, you know, in the classroom up in the concrete floor when we were learning how to drive forklifts and stuff, to where you are now, re-engaging with the youth programs, re-engaging with yourself, mate. You know, you do need to really recognize what you've done, and look, for myself personally, that's something that I'm really trying to do, because I've always been a bit, oh, you're a dickhead, acknowledge your shit, deal with your shit, you know. Hang on a minute. You also need to acknowledge the positive things that you do, not through hubris or ego, but humbly acknowledging that you still try and get up every day and be better than you were yesterday.
Yeah.
And there's positivity in that, mate. There's positivity. Well, man, that was awesome, dude. I really appreciate that. I'm super glad we sat down.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think a tripod with me, you, and Neil.
And just saying that I receive that from you.
Good.
Receive that. Thank you, man.
No worries, man. And yeah, look, we'll sort that out and we'll deep dive.
Looking forward.
We may need some assistance to help us along the way that night. We'll see how we go. Thanks, everyone. I think Brothers Keeper, man, that's the name of this one.
Yep.
Because that's obviously the brand that you've created behind a lot of this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure you send me your logo and all those things.
Yep.
So this will be next week's podcast. So
yep.
Well, you got some time to give me all the details so I can make sure they're in the show notes. Reach out to us, guys, if you want to talk to Duncan or anything else like that. I'm sure that he'd be willing to answer your questions and any questions you want us to tackle or in the next one, like, you know, we need to.
I don't know. I think like this one, just let it flow.
Yeah.
Whatever needs to come out, will come out.
Yeah.
Whatever needs to be discussed, we'll rise to the surface.
Absolutely. I know from experience that trying to shake your hand now is going to make a whole big bunch of noise. So
yeah,
we'll do that after.
Yeah. We won't shake hands, we'll hug.
Yeah, that's right, we will. We'll hug. Love you, man. Jeez, love your work.
Yeah, love you too, man. And, man, from what I've seen, the work that you've done over the last few years, you've been inspiring as well.
Thanks, man. I received that from you. So. Yeah,
it's been... And the guy, the other people that you've had on this podcast of yours, the stories I've resonated with, so many different stories I've resonated with, and it's just like, fuck, yeah, like, I really resonate with that.
Mm.
And I even sent you a message, I think, one time when I saw one of your posts. You said, oh, I haven't been doing it for very long. I don't know whether I'm going to continue to do it, blah, 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 blah. And I sent you a message, man, don't fucking stop.
Yeah, man.
Don't fucking stop.
Yeah, that's making me tear up, man, because that was, there was yourself and there was a guy from the States and there was another guy up north who basically said the same thing.
Yeah.
Don't stop.
Yeah.
You know, take a break if you need to.
Yeah.
But don't quit.
Yeah.
You know, and.
Because you're doing more than what you perceive that you do, that you're doing.
Yeah.
And reaching more that you may perceive that you're reaching on a deeper level than what you may perceive that you are.
Probably, man. I
dare say I guarantee it, man.
Yeah. But I can't think about that because then it freaks me out. But thanks, man. I really appreciate it. Good on you guys. Thanks very much. Thanks, Duncan.
Thank you.
We'll talk soon.
Cheers, bro.
Cheers.
Terror cleared the skyline and anger clouded judgments. It had spent 1,000 night times in the desert fighting something that they couldn't find. Time made us something that they couldn't find. Left us all lamenting all the wrongs that they couldn't right. This is for the second time we've been in before. From Vietnam to Saddam, we always needing a war. Neo-conservatives was up, la Viet Cong. The fingers on the trigger, we won't be here for long. They killed MLK and they named the day after. Killed JFK and then the airport after him. Some guy shot a muscle called Reagan so he could borrow a girl named Dirty Foster, if only he'd known. We tested nukes in the atmosphere for seeing the dirt. And they tested all these missiles just to see if they work. Now France got them, Russia got them, India and Pakistan, Korea want them, States want them, pointed at the Taliban, Iran and Afghanistan, sands of the Arab lands, orders from portable commands and I'm a caravan. Sitting there, 3G, cellular phones, serial killers. Many cells in their homes, and we have Manson, Bundy, Gacy, Son of Sam, Macarena, Superman, Chicken Dance, Spider Man, Generation X, and Generation Y, and the Generation X will degenerate and die. Cause we got holes in the ozone that we put there ourselves. Now the poles are a no-go, where it's cooking itself. But we can't look at ourselves, so we got saline, Botox, 18, fake tits, 19, detox, don't stop, get it, can't afford to get a credit, buy it, spend a try, get them fat. Then you better shatter dives when you do. Block a two, block a biggie. East Coast, West Coast, Fat Joe or 50. Thatcher the Shifty. Iron Lady, Tony Blair, a princess die. Some say cause she got 30 there. Whittlem, Keating, Hall, can I promise. On the children in poverty, wish I could have been honest. We have Abbott and Costello, right wing overlords. Promises and children, they threw them both overboard. Overwrought refugees, sworn to a group home or jail for the crime. Looking for a new home. Elvis died, Henry died, Lennon died. Genocide in Africa, Serbia, Cambodia. Pesticides, fire, toxins, chemical warfare. Rules, fair and love and what will work. What I'm all bearer, more terror, more unjust. Such as seizures, a tidal wave came and claimed the coast of Indonesia. Quakes in Iran, Japan to California. Greenhouse gas turned the world into a sauna. The trauma of mortars, martyrs, slaughters, of partners, mourners, fathers and daughters. They chased us, caught us, numbered us, disorders, raped us, scorned us, to break us, they bought us. Third world kidneys for captains of industry, uprising industry, corruption in the ministry. A blowjob brought about the fall of the dynasty. In MP3s saw the fall of an industry. Double population, half accommodation, carved the resources and we starved the poorer nations. Beirut, Chechnya, all hell broke loose. Berlin, 1989, man, a wall fell. Cold War, but that didn't stop more shells. Waco, let up the sky like burning oil wells. A world laid waste.
protection. Tell all world truths always strange in affection. Big brothers on poster, could TV and on cable. Reality's unscripted, celebrities for sale. Jeopardy in jail, seize the polls. Remedies and penalties for failed CEOs. We had the Enron collapsing, white collar crime versus they were taxed a dollar for a dime. The blue chip companies and blue sky mines. We no longer choose sides, we choose sidelines. On which we tried to rely both. While we're still a herd chasing lie after lie, like astronauts chasing up high in the sky. They landed on the moon but can't seem to return there. Make some question if they ever really were there. And if they were there now and they look back, could we look them in the eye? Could we look back? Cause when we look back at what we have done, can you believe all we've become? And as we walk into the sun, can you believe what we have become? As we walk into the sun.